Good morning, church. Welcome on this Easter Sunday. We're going to begin this morning by reading a passage from Luke chapter 24. On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the women took spices they had prepared and went to the tomb. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were wondering about this, suddenly two men in clothes that gleamed like lightning stood beside them. In their fright, the women bowed down with their faces to the ground, but the man said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still with you in Galilee." As the women went forward from the tomb after these events, they became the first apostles, the first in the kingdom who declared the fact that the Lord has risen. And that's what we celebrate today, the fact that Jesus has conquered death, the fact that God's plan for redemption has come entirely together, and we get to celebrate thousands of years later the fact that our God has provided for us out of his deep and passionate love. Even today, we have the same opportunity to declare all that God has done. And although we meet online now, and although we don't have the opportunity to be together, even through sharing our services on Facebook, through sharing an encouraging word on Instagram, through putting a scripture verse, we can declare the fact that God has done great things. And I know over these past number of weeks, our online attendance to our services has just gone through the roof. As more and more people, not just our own congregation members, but more people are seeing things online and searching from the comfort of their own home and having the opportunity to engage with who God is. So this morning, as we celebrate once again the healing that God has given to us, as we are reminded of what he does, we declare and testify to the fact that God is good. And God continues to work in the world, and God can provide healing to any and all who would receive it. So as we gather and worship this morning, we're going to have the opportunity to celebrate and be led in worship by part of our own church family that many of us will recognize. So before we dive into our time of worship, let's pray. Dear Father God, we thank you for this gift of life, the redemption that you have given, and the continued healing that you have made for your creation. Father God, we lift praises to your name. We sing Hosanna this morning, and remember that you are the hope of the world, and that all can find healing and fullness and peace in your arms. We give you this in your name we pray. Amen. Let's worship together.
Hello, Markham Missionary Church.
Hello.
Martin and Nancy here. We're so happy to have been asked by Sam Barry and Dory to lead you in virtual worship for this, our Easter Sunday in home isolation. It's a very strange thing, isn't it? For most of us, not even our parents, alive or past, could have foreseen such strange and disconcerting times. But we have a God who knows and understands everything we're going through. We're told in Psalm 34, "When I needed the Lord, I looked for him. I called out to him and he heard me and responded. He came and rescued me from everything that made me so afraid. Look to him and shine. This poor soul cried and the Eternal heard me. He rescued me from my troubles. The messenger of the Eternal God surrounds everyone who walks with him and is always there to protect and rescue us. Taste of his goodness. See how wonderful the Eternal truly is. Anyone who puts trust in him will be blessed and comforted." Are these promises something we can hold God to? We believe they are. Nothing can separate us from him, for in life and death, he abides with us and in us. We are safe in him one way or another. May he touch our lives right now as we all sing together these words of encouragement and praise to Jehovah Jireh, the God who provides.
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where your streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Through the
Glory. buried, he carried my sins far away.
Rising, he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day. Glorious day,
oh glorious day.
King of kings call.
The not-so-old song, Because He Lives, written by the Gaithers back in the 1960s, has this one line that should give us pause. Because he lives, all fear is gone. But is it really? With all this going on in our world right now, can we honestly say, I'm not afraid, when we know a little part of us is? Who doesn't shudder for a second thinking about getting a disease that has and will take lives? What if it's my mom? What if it's my son? What if it's me? It's human, whether you're a believer or not, to be deeply concerned about bad things and do whatever you can in your power to stop the bad things from happening. When worrisome thoughts weigh upon those who don't know Jesus, they have fear that can't easily be resolved. They don't know what's ahead if their number is up, just a hope that there may be a heaven up there and that they are good enough to be let in. But what's unique to us as Christians is we have a hope and a peace that rests over our lives like a warm blanket. For Christians who know Jesus, our fear can be and is resolved. We lift up our anxiousness to Him and He quells it. He says, I'm here with you now. I'm alive. And one day, no matter what, you'll be with me where I am. It'll all work out in the end. Will you trust me on that? And when those thoughts of God's protection and promises, permeate our minds, the fear really does start to go as the things of earth grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace. Amen.
I overcome by the power of
Good morning, church. What a wonderful day. This is a special Resurrection Sunday. We celebrate, Christians around the world, they are celebrating this one specific, most glorious event in the history of the world, and that is Jesus rose from the dead. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Now for those who are listening in online around the world, if you are not a believer, if you are not a Christian, this is what I tell you today, this morning. Give me some time, and I'll explain to you why this is so very important. Why Christians around the world are celebrating, rejoicing, because Jesus rose from the dead. Okay, but what is resurrection? What is the resurrection? Very simple, the resurrection is overcoming death. Imagine this. Just think about it. How crazy this is. You are dead in the grave, and all of a sudden, bang, you come back to life. There's nothing. I mean, I'm telling you, there's nothing like it. Anyway, well, let's have a word of prayer. Lord, I want to thank you this morning. Thank you so very much for what you have done, for what you have accomplished. There's nothing like it. We know, Lord Jesus, that you have given your life. You went to the grave. You spent 3 days in a grave. And bang, you rose up again. You overcame death. And Lord, here we are today in this hope, in this joy, in this celebration as Christians around the world. And even sharing with everyone else that this is the most important message ever in the history of the world. Thank you so very much. As we go through this, Lord, as we go for the facts here this morning, help us, Lord, to understand, to grasp, and to believe even more firmly of what you have done. In Jesus' name. The people of God say, amen. Praise the Lord. Okay, let's get our facts. Let's get our facts first from the most reliable source, and that is the Bible. And for those who don't believe in the Bible, I thank you. If you start studying the Bible, you will be in awe. You will be in shock in how 100% accurate in everything it says. And don't take my word for it. You do your own study. You do your own digging. You go to archaeologies. You go to all these people that are knowing what they're talking about. And you will find out that the Bible cannot lie. In a little bit, we'll talk more about that. Well, let's go to the facts here on that day, on this Sunday morning, on the first day of the week. Here is what it says from Luke chapter 24. On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the woman took the spices they had prepared and they went to the tomb. And they found the stone rolled away from the tomb. But when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. And while they were wondering about this, suddenly two men in clothes that gleamed like lightning stood beside them. And in their fright, the woman bowed down with their faces to the ground, but the man said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He is risen. Remember how he told you while he was still with you in Galilee. And the Son of Man must be delivered over the hands of sinners, be crucified, and on the third day raised again." Then they remembered his words. And when they came back from the tomb, they told all these things to the 11, you know, the disciples, and to all the others. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanne, Mary, the mother of James, and the others with them who told this to the apostles. But they did not believe the woman. You know, they did not believe that somebody raises from the dead. Of course, this is a hard thing to believe. But hang in there, we'll prove it to you this morning. But they did not believe the woman because their words seemed to them like nonsense. Peter, however, he got up He ran to the tomb. Bending over, he saw the strips of lining lying by themselves, and he went away wondering to himself what had happened. He on the road to Emmaus. Now that same day, two of them were going to the village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. And they were talking with each other about everything that had happened. And as they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked with them, but they were kept from recognizing him. And he asked them, "What are you discussing about together as you walk along?" They stood still, their faces downcast. One of them, named Cleopas, asked him, "Are you the only one visiting Jerusalem and who does not know the things that have happened in these last days?" "What things?" Jesus asked. "About Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. And the chief priests and our rulers, they handed him over to be crucified, sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. And what is more, it is the third day since all these took place. In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning, but they didn't find the body. And they came and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive." Then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the woman had said, but they did not see Jesus. And he said to them, "How foolish," now this is from verse 25, "how foolish you are, and how slow to believe all that the prophets had spoken. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory?" And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. Wow. So let me just to get started here. Let's talk about these are the facts. These are the facts of the Bible. Now let's put some facts that are within the facts of the resurrection. One could even say the tragic facts. You know, we're talking about something here that we should not blame the people at that time. In fact, we are very much like them. And that's the signs of unbelief that you see through this entire scripture. I know it's hard. It's hard to believe that somebody could actually raise from the dead. But we see the signs of unbelief in the woman, for example. Like, for example, on the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the woman took the spices they had prepared and they went to the tomb. Now, if you take spices to a tomb, what are you thinking in doing? You're thinking about embalming the body or some type of thing, but not even coming close to your mind that actually Jesus would have risen from the dead. So, lack of faith, unbelief. There are more signs of unbelief by the woman. So they found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they entered, they did not find the body. And while they were wondering about this, suddenly two men in clothes that gleamed like lightning stood beside them. In their fright, the woman bowed down with their faces to the ground. But the man said to them, why do you look for the living among the dead? Why? You're not supposed to. Don't you remember what he said? He's not here, they say. The angels say, he has risen. The Son of Man must be delivered over to the hands of sinners, be crucified, and then on the third day be raised again. And then they remembered his words. Now, continue on with this facts within the facts of the resurrection. We have the apostles who did also not believe. Just verse 9 here. when they came back from the tomb, they told all these things to the 11 and to all the others. But they did not believe the woman, because their words seemed to be like nonsense. So the apostles, the woman really didn't really believe. The apostles didn't really believe. It reminds me of a story back in Brazil. One day, a fine man, not too old, a younger, middle-aged man, he had passed away. And we as pastors, we decided, hey, you know, this man is so important. What if we go and pray and we raise him up from the dead? I wasn't personally present, but pastor's friend of mine, they went to pray. And it's interesting that the widow of this deceased, she thought, you know what? I'm gonna go with you. And to make sure, I'm gonna take a suit and a pair of shoes along. Because if he raises from the dead, at least he will have some shoes to put on. Now, what happened? Ultimately, the man didn't actually rise from the dead. He probably would have not been very friendly with us if eventually we would have called him back. Because once you're up in heaven, you don't want to come back. I mean, you don't want to come back. Well, the fact of the matter is, this woman actually believed. And she went on this encounter of prayer with a pair of shoes. If he rises from the dead, I will have shoes for him. But in this story here, they went with embalming oil and all kinds of to embalm the body, because they knew, they believed that he was dead and the body was there and they needed to do something. So they didn't believe. Now also we have the disciples didn't believe, the apostles didn't believe, the woman didn't believe, and the regular Christian also did not believe. Like on the road to Emmaus, the story we just read, they said in verse 21, we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. But now, too bad, he's dead, unfortunately. In fact, they talk about, the woman said they had seen an empty tomb and they didn't find the body. So they also had this idea of the body. They couldn't really see the body. And they believed that, well, if it's a body, that means the person is dead. They didn't believe on the words of Jesus. And then verse 25, Jesus says to them, how foolish you are. And how slow to believe all that the prophets have said, have spoken. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory? Now number three, we have the facts of the resurrection. And that this is the facts about the timing of the resurrection. Now this goes really, if you are a skeptic, you should pay attention to this. If you are listening, whatever, in the four corners of this planet, if you are listening to this message, and if you want to know that the Bible is accurate regarding what it describes about the resurrection of Jesus, if you are a skeptic, you should pay attention to this, because it will prove that the Bible is absolute accurate and very precise. In fact, if you understand a little bit about the Bible, first of all, you will come to the grasp, to the understanding that the Bible is absolutely truth. There are no mistakes in the Bible. Some skeptics will say there are some mistakes here and there, but if you add everything up, you will see zero mistakes. It does not contradict with nothing. It is absolutely the absolute, final, decisive truth. So the question here is, why or what time, what was the timing of Jesus' resurrection? Well, when did Jesus rise from the dead so that the prophecy could be fulfilled? So if the Bible is right, and it always is, Jesus had to rise at the time of the feasts of first fruit. We know that he died at Passover, at the Passover feast. And it was in the grave. He was in the grave during the Feast of Unleavened Bread. That's just 2 days later. And he rose on the Feast of First Fruit, the third feast from the seven feasts of Israel, given by God to appoint times. One of the most incredible studies that you can ever do, and I want to encourage you to do it, to study the seven feasts of Israel. Seven feasts. Of course, with God, everything is seven. So the seven feasts of Israel we have. It starts with the Feast of Passover, the Feast of Unleavened Bread, the Feast of First Fruits, then the Feast of Pentecost, then the Feast of Trumpets, then the Feast of Atonement, then finally the Feast of Tabernacles, with including the 8 day within the feast. So we know that the Feast of Passover has all to do with the leaving of Egypt, where God told the people to put a blood on the door frames of the blood on the door frames, so that the angel of death would pass over and would not damage or would not kill the firstborn of every person that had no blood on the door. So Passover. And Jesus became, and you know, for every blood, every family blood, they were supposed to butcher, slaughter a small lamb, and put that blood of that lamb on the door, on the door frames. And it became the Passover lamb. Now Jesus is the Passover lamb, representing something that what they did in the past there was something that was a representative of something that Jesus Christ would be the final sacrifice for the final Passover lamb of God that would take away the sin of the world. Anyway, after Passover we have the unleavened bread. It has all to do with, it was during the time that Jesus Christ was in the grave. Now they were celebrating this feast over the years, over the generations, and the Old Testament, the Feast of Unleavened Bread, where they would have a house, where they had to clean the house, no leaven in the house, they would have to eat unleavened bread without yeast. Yeast usually represents sin, and that was that feast. And then Jesus, when did he die? Or when was he in the grave? He was in the grave during the time of unleavened bread, where he was actually taking away the sin of the world. And then we have the Feast of First Fruits. That's when Jesus resurrected. That's about 3 days later, on the day of first fruit. But why is this important, and what does it mean? Well, what are the first fruits? Very small, very rapidly here. From the Old Testament, in Leviticus chapter 23 verses 9 to 14 says this: Then the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, Speak to the sons of Israel, and say to them, When you enter the land which I am going to give you, and reap its harvest, then you shall bring in the sheaf of the first fruits of your harvest to the priest, and you shall wave it, the sheaf, before the Lord, for you to be accepted. And this is basically what it's all about. Jesus Christ, he had to rise on this day, on the day that this feast was being celebrated. You cannot decide, unless you are God, unless you are who do you say you are, you cannot put yourself, your body back into action after you're dead in a very specific day, on the feast of first fruits. So this feast, dear brothers and dear sisters, and everyone that is not a believer here. This feast represents that Jesus Christ is the first fruit. He is the first one that is rose from the dead to never die again. He is the first one. After him, everybody else who believes in him will pass on, will eventually rise from the dead as well. So we're talking about Jesus could not have risen from the dead at any time. It had to be specifically on this very day, because this was the day of first fruits, a sign, a signal of God all the way from the Old Testament. So Jesus became the first fruits. Okay, well, what's the proof of the resurrection? Well, first of all, by resurrecting from the dead, Jesus proves who he says he is. I mean, in John 10:17 it says, this is so important. Take a listen. John 10:17-18 says this. This is why the Father loves me. Jesus saying here, because I laid down my life, and he did it free willingly. I laid down my life in order to take it back again. No one is taking it from me. I lay it down of my own free will. I have the authority to lay it down, and I have the authority to take it back again. This is what my Father has commanded me. So he told us in advance, guys, you know, listen to this. They're gonna kill me, so and so. They're gonna put me in the grave, but no worries. I'll come back, okay? If he would be a fake, like I say, if he would be fake news, if he would be false, he would die and remain dead. But this guy called Jesus, he says, you know what? Hey, listen, I'm gonna die, but wait for me. In 3 days, I'll be back. Can you think about something more powerful than this? And it is proven that the tomb is empty in Jerusalem. It was there personally. It's dead. It's empty. It's gone. It's just, Jesus is no longer there. Hallelujah. Okay, what else proves that Jesus rose from the dead? Well, so after the resurrection, he appeared. First of all, he appeared to Mary Magdalene near the sepulcher in Jerusalem. That is Mark chapter 16, verses 9. You can read it, Mark 16, verse 9. He also appeared to other women returning from the sepulcher. They saw him. Matthew 28, verses 9-10. He showed up to Peter near Jerusalem later that same day. Then he showed to all, you know, we read that, to the two disciples that was on their way to Emmaus in Mark chapter 16, verse 12. Then he also showed up in the evening to all the apostles in the city of Jerusalem, except for Thomas. And now Thomas, you know, he wasn't there. He, all of a sudden, he shows up in the middle of the room. The doors were closed. He just, bang, gets in there. He crosses the walls. Then later, Thomas saw him. And he also showed himself to the seven disciples one day on the Sea of Galilee. At one point, he showed himself to over 500 people. 500 people saw him at once. This is incredible. This is amazing. He showed himself to his brother James, supposedly his own brother, in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 7. To the apostles during the 40 days prior to his ascension, he talked to them in various occasions. He showed himself to the 12 apostles on the Mount of Olives just before the ascension. And after his ascension, he still appeared to people, like to Stephen. We have that in Acts chapter 7:55. Acts 7:55. Then he appeared also to Saul on Damascus. In Damascus. He was on a road to Damascus. And there Saul saw him. 1 Corinthians 15, 8 and 9. He also appeared to John, one of the disciples, one of the apostles, out there in the island of Patmos. It is also archaeologically proven that there was an empty tomb 3 days after Jesus was laid in it. The other thing is very interesting. If it wouldn't be true, why in the world would the apostles be willing to die for this truth? In fact, most of them, or just about everybody of these 12 apostles, they were willing, they died a very difficult death. But they would not say, no, Jesus didn't rise from the dead. Because they were willing to die. This Jesus, whom we have known personally, he rose again. He died. We saw him dead on a cross. But then, yeah, we had some hard time to believe. Yeah, it was at one point it was very difficult. But then he showed himself so many times after, there is absolutely no doubts left in our hearts. Jesus rose from the dead. And if you want to kill me for it, please go right ahead. So this is what happened. The disciples, they died for this very truth. If it wouldn't be the truth, do you think they would be willing to die? They were absolutely convinced. Now, what is the reason or the importance of the undeniable fact that Jesus rose from the dead? Why is it important? Why is it important that Jesus rose from the dead? First of all, you read in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 17 to 19. And if Christ has not been raised, then our faith is useless. And you are still in condemnation for your sins. And if you have hope in Christ only for this life, we are the most miserable people in the world. It's also important because the resurrection is important because it establishes the church of God. I find this very interesting because in Matthew chapter 16, Jesus says, I will build my church and death will not stop it. Whew! You know, basically, he's saying, you know what? I have a bride. I have chosen a bride, the church. And I'm going to get married with her. Now, if the bride dies, what's the point? Doesn't make sense. He had to rise. He had to raise the bride. He had to make the possibility of raising back the bride to life. And he says, I gave my life for the bride, for my church, for you and me who is a believer. And if I did it, I mean it. So there will be nothing in between us, not even death. This is so good. I mean, this is so good, so refreshing. Knowing that after this, after everything has been done, you will rise from the dead. Whoo! So good. See, the resurrection, one other thing that the resurrection does, it brings the whole a new perspective of life. It brings a change of mind about the meaning of this world. See, everything is meaningless, like Solomon was already saying. He was the richest man, one of the richest kings in the history of Israel and probably the world. He had so much gold and so much everything. He was a very, very rich man. And in the end, he says, everything is meaningless because I'm going to die, I'm going to go to the grave. If that would be the end. But that is not the end. Yes, accumulating wealth and having all kinds of things and all kinds of joys in the world, but then you die? And that's it? There's no point in that. There's also the joy of heaven. It's another reason why Jesus rose from the dead. It is giving you a hope. He's giving you a putting into your heart the joy of something he promised. What did he promise? He gave you heaven. There is a place after this. Bible talks about a new heaven and a new earth where you and I, who are believers, will live forever. You know, today we might endure pain and grief and suffering, but because Christ's death was followed by his resurrection, we can know that such things are temporary. It's just for a little while. You and I, we will suffer for a little while. There are so much greater things awaiting for us after this. I'm talking about greater things. The Bible says, no ear has heard, no eyes have seen, not even has it crossed the mind, the human mind, what the Lord has prepared for those who love him. Dear listener, dear church, there is something that the Lord, through the resurrection, has prepared for you. He will rise you for a purpose. He came for a purpose. He forgave your sin for a purpose. That is to give you eternal life, not death. And because of the resurrection, we are destined to live forever in new bodies, in this new heaven and new earth. Is there any greater joy? I mean, is there anything bigger than this? You can search. There is not. And if you are a skeptic, if you are not a believer, right now I tell you, give the Lord Jesus a chance. Tell him, Lord, here's my life. You know, you say you are Jesus, you say you are powerful. Show it to me. Because I am truly surrendering my life to you. And I will promise you, and I promise you, Jesus Christ, he will show himself to you. If you are a true, sincere seeker, if you truly believe, he will forgive your sin. And guess what? Even if you die, he will raise you up on the last day. He will do it. Isn't that wonderful? Find a church. If you don't have a church, find a church. Go to a church, talk to a pastor, talk to any Christian around you. Ask him questions. He will answer. They will answer. They have answers. We all, as Christians, we have answers because we get our answers from the Bible. It's so true. And we, for those who do believe, like you and me, for those who do believe, we can celebrate forever and ever that this truth is actually the truth, and we will live. Hallelujah. Shall we pray? God, we thank you. We thank you, Lord, that there is nothing more important than this news, that you rose from the dead. And you are the first fruit of those who would come after you. You open up the harvest. The first one who died to never, and you rose again from the dead to never die again. And now this is all for us too. You gave it to us. We are right behind you. We are part of this amazing, incredible harvest. And Lord, we want to thank you. And we pray, Lord Jesus, since you came to forgive our sin, help us to repent. In fact, Lord, we live in a time where the world is on this pandemic, where everybody or nobody really knows what comes next. But Lord, for those who do believe in you, we can trust and we can be at peace. Because you already covered everything. You covered every corner. And for the most part, Lord Jesus, we know that if we die, we will live again, because you will lift us up. Thank you so very much, Lord Jesus. In your name, Jesus, we do pray. Amen. Thank you for listening. May the Lord bless you very, very much.
What a fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. What a blessedness, what a peace is mine, leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all.
Dear church and dear online listener, thank you so very much for being with us this morning. Think about this incredible idea that Jesus Christ, he rose from the dead. And because he did it, so will you, if you trust him. May the grace and the peace and the joy and the fellowship of God the Father and of Jesus Christ the Son and of the Holy Spirit be with you today and forever. Amen. Blessings to you, and I guess I will see you when I see you. Bye-bye.